Mercifully, India has no Ebola case so far, but equally, that could change without warning and perhaps even very suddenly. So how prepared is India for its first Ebola case, when and if that happens? That's the key issue I shall pursue in an interview with the Health Minister, Dr. Harshvardhan. Dr. Harshvardhan, let me start with a simple question. It's a question that many Indians today want to hear the answer to. As Health Minister, are you confident that India is prepared for the first Ebola case whenever it happens?
Yes, I am prepared to the best possible extent and I am thoroughly confident about it. And it's not just an emotional thing that I say, because the preparations that we have done, I think we have worked proactively on this front. We have been doing something much more than any other country in the world. Even today itself, the WHO doesn't recommend that we should screen people actively, aggressively and scientifically at the entry points into the countries. They recommend only at the exit point. We are doing it from the day one at 18 airports where there could be direct or indirect connection with those Ebola-affected countries.
So your preparation is actually in advance of and ahead of WHO requirements?
I think so.
Which means that as Health Minister, you're saying to the people of India that you are confident India is fully prepared.
I'm saying that as Health Minister also, as a doctor also, as a technical man also, as a scientific person also.
Let's then go through the different steps of preparation necessary and let's begin with the steps you've taken to try and prevent Ebola entering the country. Now you've got temperature screening at international airports, particularly for passengers coming from Ebola affected countries. And I believe something like 25,000 people have already been screened.
Yes.
My question is, how effective is temperature screening as a way of keeping Ebola out of the country?
You see, please appreciate that it is not only these thermal scans. These thermal scans are basically to detect that if somebody is not reporting that he has fever, then there is a machine which detects. But there is a detailed evaluation form.
If you look at the form. The so-called green card given on planes.
Yes, yes, from the point a person enters the airport, he gets into the plane, then he gets out of the plane, then he enters the airport, then he goes to the health officials at the airport, he goes to immigration. At every point, there is so much of thorough checking mechanism with detailed information system.
That I appreciate, but the problem with temperature screening, which is the main facility that you set up to try and detect, is this. By the time an Ebola carrier has temperature, he or she is already infectious. So your temperature screening might identify a carrier, but the infection could have entered the country anyway. That's
you
the
see,
problem.
You see, the number one, there is already a screening going on at the point when a person from an Ebola-affected country, he leaves that country. We are taking double precaution. It is a double check, further check. And then even if there is a slightest doubt about the symptoms that we get to know while he is inside himself, we isolate that patient, we send him to the nearest lab that is also close to
the
airport.
Except that if you get to know about symptoms on board the plane, then there's a great danger that everyone else on board that plane heading to India is also potentially infected. So instead of one carrier, you could end up with a plane load full of carriers.
You see, for that also, there is an advanced system. We have trained all our aircraft crew also about it, and there are further training mechanisms going
but
on.
But at the end of the day, Dr. Harshvardhan, aircraft crew are aircraft crew. They are not qualified medical professionals. So whatever training you give them is bound to be inadequate. You're asking them to handle an emergency, but without the specialist knowledge.
You see, whatever is required at that time of that point of time, I think that's enough. You see, you cannot have a doctor at every place, but number one, such patients will thoroughly be taken care of at the exit points. We are in
touch. This is very interesting. You're saying that all Ebola affected countries, and there are six of them at least, two of which have now been cleared, have exit point screening.
Yes.
The problem is that only works if they're coming directly from that Ebola affected country to India. If they come via a third country, and many people do, there is no exit screening in that intermediate country.
No problem, sir. Even then, at all our 18 airports where there could be a direct flight or there could be an indirect flight, At every place there are multiple check systems.
Can you not do something more? Can you not insist that every passenger boarding a plane coming to India at the last point of departure before India must be temperature screened, no matter where he's coming from, whether he's coming from Europe or America, because there's this danger that Ebola sufferers, if they're coming from an Ebola country, could come via a third country. So why not say at the last point of departure before India,
you see,
no matter which country,
you see,
will be screened?
We, our civil aviation department, is in touch with, number one, all the Indian airlines, all the international airlines, and all possible possibilities of either a direct connection or an indirect connection, which you are mentioning. They have all been thoroughly taken care of. That's what I'm saying. We are many steps ahead of the rest of the world.
I understand that in your planning,
yes,
it's thoroughly taken care of. But I'm suggesting something else. I'm saying that at the last point of departure before India, whether that last point is in a border country, whether it's in Europe or America or wherever, insist that those passengers must be temperature screened before they get onto the plane.
You see, this is something which is not under Dr. Harshvardhan's control. After all, the rest of the countries of the world, they have their own guiding principles.
You can't force
WHO has a guiding principle for the rest of the world. And we are doing our best on our side. We are taking, you see, WHO has officially, in a letter written to me 2 days back itself, where they keep reviewing everything every week. WHO on record has appreciated the efforts of India, and they have said India is doing extremely well.
Let me put one other thing to you. I grant that India is doing extremely well in terms of its theoretical planning. The problem is that at the end of the day, planning may never match up to the nature of the problem when it hits you.
Yes.
Have you considered the possibility of banning or barring all passengers from Ebola affected countries? Or do you think that's A, too draconian, and B, it can be circumvented because they've come via second and third countries?
You see, number one, that may not be fair scientifically also. We have discussed this issue. We have had deliberations with all the international players. We have discussions with the technical people also.
So this has been considered?
This was considered even in the first meeting.
And then ruled out on the grounds it may not be fair?
Ruled out. And not only fair, but I think scientifically also that may not be required.
Now, one stage of preventing Ebola entering the country is the screening. It's all the forms that people have to fill up when they board the plane, the details they have to give of their medical history, etc.
Yes.
There's a second problem. When you do the screening, there's a large number of people who are identified as suspects.
Yes.
Those suspects continue to be, in a sense, in quotes, threatened for a 22-day period. Do you have effective procedures and protocols,
yes,
to accurately and continuously monitor them during that 22-day period,
yes,
when they could end up possibly with Ebola?
You see, I'll explain to you. There is a well-defined classification. Even amongst these patients who will have symptoms suggesting direct or indirect something like maybe Ebola-like symptoms. Symptoms you know very well. It could be fever, it could be pain in abdomen, it could be headache, it could be
diarrhea,
pain in muscles, diarrhea,
sure,
vomiting, nausea, pain in joints, and all those things. We have categories: low risk, mid risk, or you can say moderate risk, or high risk. For every category, there is a very well-defined criteria, number one. These patients are either kept into that quarantine for 21 days, that's number one. Then, if there is a moderate risk patient, where there is a definite history of some sort of, even an indirect contact with somebody who had Ebola somewhere or something, we, from the airport itself, we isolate that patient, take him to a nearest hospital. Say, suppose I talk about Delhi itself, there is a very there is a quarantine set up near the airport itself. He will be taken there, his blood sample will be taken, the sample will be tested, and only when he is tested negative, then only he is let off from there.
This is very reassuring. One problem that occurs to me is that many of the symptoms of Ebola are similar to those of chikungunya,
yes,
or dengue. How do you ensure that you don't mistake one for the other? Or is that a risk you have to take anyway?
You see, on the basis of symptoms, and then the most important thing here is that he has a history of contact in that country. He is traveling from that Ebola-affected country, plus then we are doing that test, which is very specific for Ebola. There's a PCR test that you are doing in
so
your labs.
So that immediately identifies the patient as Ebola rather than dengue or chikungunya.
Yes, yes, obviously.
Now, the newspapers have said, and I'm sure you'll confirm this for me in a moment's time, that starting the 27th of October, you will have a four-member rapid response team in each state.
Yes.
This will comprise a general physician,
Epidemiologist, microbiologist,
and a nurse.
Yes.
The question is, how well trained are these people for the task of monitoring and checking a large number of people who are entering and are considered suspect for 22 days? How good is the training?
You see, let me explain this to you, this whatever you have interpreted from this newspaper report. Number one, we have world-class integrated surveillance system in the country right now, which is even endorsed by WHO. That's one thing. Then it is not only this team is already existing at the state level and even at the district levels. They are already aware of the epidemiology, microbiology, and the role as a physician. But now we are giving them further training, further sensitization with reference to Ebola also.
Absolutely.
Further. It is not that they don't know it, but they have already been trained about it.
I accept you're giving them further training. The Hindustan Times says you're going to give them training in terms of WHO protocols as well as the protocols of the American Center for Disease Control and Prevention.
Yes, yes.
But do you have enough time to give them training? Because this needs weeks. It's not an overnight process. And you could get your first Ebola case, God forbid, tomorrow.
You see, it is not that they are, number one, ignorant people. They have all, last 2 months, 3 months, we have had communication, massive communication with every person in the health system about Ebola through all possible mechanisms.
So the training has been happening for two months.
All possible mechanisms that are required. Now what we are doing is we are creating master trainers further to make sure that the people.
How much time do these master trainers need to ensure that these response teams in each state are trained adequately?
We already have done once from 19th to 21st further.
October.
Just now we have, this is a, you can say, super specialized sort of training. Already these people know how to handle, they have handled so many other diseases.
So it's adequate training is happening, you're confident
adequate,
of that?
Adequate training is happening. We are further strengthening it to, I think, the best possible level.
Okay. Now, beyond training, there's also the question of testing people who you think are suspect. You may have to test in thousands. If some of the worst predictions come true,
yes.
You may have to test in tens of thousands.
Yes, yes.
You have already established 12 laboratories in the country. The key question is this. Do those laboratories have adequate facilities, A, in terms of equipment, and more importantly, in terms of trained manpower?
Yes. I would say perfect yes.
To both?
You see, yes.
Equipment and
yes,
manpower?
Yes. Right now, you see, we have made two labs functional because depending upon the load. That is, you see, right now we required
That's
only
Pune
some...
Pune and Delhi.
Yeah, Pune and Delhi. Something like 100 people required this testing till now.
But there are 10 more labs you've identified.
We have adequate preparations. With the press of a button, we can ask those 10 labs also to join in.
So if the WTO's worst predictions come true, and I underline that they're predictions and they're worst case scenarios, that you need perhaps to be testing 10,000 people at a go.
Yes.
You are adequately equipped in terms of equipment and manpower.
I think we have had a lot of discussions on this. We have had ample preparations and we are fully equipped to augment and strengthen if at all there is a need for anything further also.
Even up to the need of say 10,000 a week or something.
You see, that way technically it could be 125 crore Indians. You see, that's not physically possible.
Within proper
feasibility. But you see, Ebola is not something, it doesn't spread by an airborne transmission. You have to appreciate
that. But it does spread
it only gets from one person to another when you get in contact with some body fluid.
Absolutely.
Or blood or something. It's not like airborne, it goes into millions and thousands of people.
Ebola can also be contracted when you're washing a dead patient before burial or cremation.
Obviously.
That is a very vulnerable point for Indian society.
That is why there are very definite guidelines for handling an Ebola patient or a suspected patient, which all our health workers at these facilities...
Let me come to those guidelines in a moment's time. Let me ask you one more question about screening and testing. Recently, just before Diwali, the newspapers reported the French have come up with a do-it-at-home very simple 15-minute test for Ebola, much like a do-it-yourself pregnancy test. Now, I know it's not as yet approved by regulators, but it has gone into mass production in France anyway. Are you considering importing it and using it here?
I don't. You see, for a disease like Ebola, you cannot experiment on the community. All these new things or new happenings in the medical world, they have to be tested, they have to be approved by the authorized agencies, and they have to be approved by WHO. You can't just on the basis of hearsay or something appearing in the media. I cannot make Indians guinea pigs for that. I don't think
so
that
you're
is
reluctant
that,
to take this step.
That is not required, not reluctant. That's not required. That is scientifically incorrect also.
Let's then move beyond. We've talked about steps you're taking to try and prevent Ebola entering the country. We've talked about steps that you're taking to identify and monitor suspects. We've talked about the response teams and the training that they've gotten. You're adequately confident as health minister that on all these three fronts, India's preparation is fine. Let's then come to that critical stage when, God forbid, India gets its first Ebola case. Now, you've identified a hospital in each state,
yes,
which has an isolation facility,
yes,
where, in fact, these patients will be treated.
Yes.
My question is this. How adequately prepared are those hospitals for the enormous challenge they could face?
You see, I would say that this aspect also we are monitoring at different levels. I personally had a detailed meeting with the health secretaries in Delhi on 9th of this month.
All the state health secretaries?
All the health secretaries, and there was 100% attendance. We had a meeting that starting from morning till night, but it was not only for Ebola, it was for all health issues, but we discussed Ebola. Then our cabinet secretary, he had a detailed, you can say, and he has been reviewing it regularly like me at the national level with the chief secretaries. Then I would say, even for these hospitals, for these airports, we have made teams of seniors who are going all over the country now to inspect for themselves.
That's the question.
Whether the facilities they feel, if at all there is a remote possibility of something which has to be strengthened. We are taking no chances at all.
That's the question I want to ask. You actually have teams from the health ministry visiting these designated
health
hospitals
ministry
to
and,
check.
And of course, the we have taken help of the civil aviation people also. We have taken help of the
experts
also.
But let's stick now to hospitals. You have teams from the health ministry, yes, teams of senior officials who are checking on these designated hospitals,
yes,
to see they are adequately prepared.
Yes, yes.
Now, as you know, in theory, on paper, no doubt we will be adequately prepared, fingers crossed. The problem is that in a country like America, which many believe has perhaps the most advanced health facilities in the world, two nurses treating an Ebola patient got the infection themselves. How confident are you that our nurses in India, our medical staff in India will be better protected?
You see, as far as training is concerned, even amongst these master trainers also, we have kept these nurses also. Plus, you see, in all these hospitals, we are making them adequately trained, sensitized. We did a mock drill also.
In each of these hospitals?
No, not each of these hospitals, but for the whole procedure, we made a dummy patient who has already contracted Ebola.
Shouldn't you do that mock drill in each of the designated hospitals, because you don't know where the first Ebola patient will happen?
We did this mock drill only recently. We will replicate it in other places also, wherever there is a need.
Is there a danger, Dr. Harshvardhan, that medical staff or nurses who have to treat an Ebola patient, when and if India gets one, could actually contract the disease or become infected themselves? Is there a danger?
You see, that is scientifically a big danger if the personal protective equipment and the scientific techniques to handle such patients, to handle the other equipments, etc., if they are not taken care of properly. Because you see, even as per the WHO report, something like 450 or 443 health workers got affected all over the world, and out of that, half of them died,
and
unfortunately.
You know, many of them, Dr. Harshvardhan, got infected, in fact, despite the fact that they had protective gear, because they weren't aware of how to remove the
you
gear.
See,
often, faulty removal of protective gear leads to infection.
That is why even you see our people in India, it is not the first time. You see, Ebola is a new virus or whatever, but we have
Ebola, it's not a new virus.
New virus in the sense that for India we are talking about it right now, although we I know there had been 24
it's new for India
epidemics earlier also. What I'm trying to say that our health community has handled so many other diseases in the past. It is not that they are handling such infections except for the first time.
There I agree.
We are further sensitizing them for Ebola.
Except that Ebola is even more threatening and more dangerous than HIV.
Yes.
Right? Let me put this to you. Have you got top quality protective gear for your nurses and medical staff? And secondly, have you got it in sufficient numbers?
You see, I will tell you that we already got 10,000 of them. We have already sent them to all the states.
That's all the states?
Yes.
All 28?
All the states we have sent them. The 18 states are the ones where you have all these patients and all, where likely patients from the Ebola affected countries, either directly
and
or indirectly.
And they have adequate protective gear.
So right now they have already got it. Plus, we have a mechanism whereby we can further order and get these personal protective equipment.
But 10,000 personal protective equipment have already been disseminated through India.
Yes, yes, they have already been sent to 18 states.
Now, as we've been discussing, the main thrust of the government's policy and strategy for treating Ebola patients, if they happen in India, is through designated government hospitals. But what happens if someone fears they have the symptoms and goes to a private hospital? Have private hospitals been informed of the protocol? Have they been informed of details how to handle Ebola?
You see, we have through our website, through all the mechanisms, you see, I communicate through something like 40 lakh emails. And we have had communication with the Indian Medical Association, which has something like 7 lakh doctors all over the country. So the Indian
this
Medical
includes doctors in the private hospital.
Doctors, you see, Indian Medical Association, yeah. Most of the doctors.
You've been in touch with them through email personally.
Not only touch, we are practically reviewing, monitoring. They have developed their own protocols. They are also simultaneously working on
so
all that.
So private hospitals are in the loop as far as Ebola is concerned.
Yes, yes,
they're fully aware of the protocols,
obviously.
They're fully aware of procedures for handling Ebola patients.
We are impressing upon them time and again through meetings, also through the Indian Medical Association, also through all possible, if you go to the website, you will find all possible informations there. We are trying to connect with every doctor in the country through the mechanisms which are possible. And
all of this, Health Minister, is very reassuring. Let me nonetheless quote to you what Margaret Chan, the Director General of the WHO, has said about Ebola. She says, Ebola is the most severe acute health emergency in modern times. And then she adds, I have never seen a health event threaten the very survival of societies and governments in already poor countries. I have never seen an infectious disease contribute so strongly to potential state failure. Now, those are very strong words. Do you agree with her or do you disagree?
I think I would say that in a way she is right. You see, she is the Director General of WHO. She has to try and put everything in the right perspective. She needs to forewarn everybody in the world. And the bad thing about Ebola is that it has a very high mortality rate. The good thing is it doesn't spread by an airborne or a foodborne transmission. So obviously, something which has a very, very high mortality rate, you have to put your heart and soul into it. You have to have the most aggressive strategies. And I think that's the part of her strategy. You see,
one of the things that worries people, Dr. Saab, is that in fact, it's not just while the infected person is alive that he or she can spread the disease. The dead body of someone who died of Ebola can also spread the disease.
Obviously.
How you handle dead bodies is something Indians would have to be made aware of. God forbid we get to that situation.
Obviously, there is a protocol for everything. After all, a dead body will start from a hospital system or a place where the treatment is going on. And then, we are only thinking of a theoretical possibility. There are adequate protocols, mechanisms,
for all of this.
Guidelines for everything. Everything is available on the website also further.
Let me end this interview by putting two quick questions to you. Do you think that the press in particular, but perhaps civil society more widely, is adequately focused on Ebola, or do you think in this regard perhaps the press has been somewhat negligent?
I would say that we can probably appeal to the media to give further good quality information on Ebola. The media can play a very great role in educating the masses in our country.
And as Health Minister, you are asking the media
today to do that. Yes, I would certainly. You see, I would forewarn in the sense that we should not be going up to the extent of creating unnecessary panic. There are many issues, in fact, where we said, no, we don't have to do this. It will unnecessarily
create a panic. What you're saying is don't frighten, but please educate and make aware.
Yes, that's essential. That's essential.
You therefore like more thoughtful, well-researched articles informing people of Ebola,
yes.
Informing people of how it's caught,
yes.
Informing people of steps that are being taken,
yes.
To control or to prevent.
Yes, yes.
One last question. Recently, it was reported that Baba Ramdev's organization claimed that they had an Ayurvedic cure for Ebola. Now, you know and I know there are no cures for Ebola at all. Subsequently, Baba Ramdev's organization has denied the report, or at least they've distanced themselves from it.
Yes.
But do you think the time has come for the government to strongly A, refute such claims, and B, perhaps admonish people who try to mislead innocent people into believing there is a cure when there is no cure?
You see, as Health Minister, as a man who is dealing with the affairs related to health, and then now Ebola you are talking about, you see, I have lot of faith in the, you can say, power of Ayurveda. But as on today, there is nothing like any known treatment for Ebola, at least on record.
Which is why Baba Ramdev's organization's claim was, as you know and I know, rubbish.
And worse still,
it's misleading innocent people.
I would say that any claim by anybody on this account without any scientific backing, proved by international, national standards and by the scientific protocols, I would say that's not worth propagating in the country. It would create unnecessary confusion, might mislead the people. So for the time being, if somebody has something, let it be subjected to the most powerful scientific scrutiny first. And then if the scientific scrutiny passes something, then we talk about it after approval from the World Health Organization. That is what I would suggest.
Health Minister, that's perfectly clear. A pleasure talking to you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.